Okay. Hi, welcome to our talk, Trust is Good, Control is Better, a short story about network policies, and a short introduction about ourselves.
Yeah, I'm Maximilian, I'm working as a cloud platform engineer.
This one? Okay. Yeah. So I'm Maximilian. I'm working as cloud platform engineer at InnoVex. This mostly means, currently at least in my current project, working with Kubernetes. So we're building Istio on top of an existing Kubernetes cluster for a customer. And yeah, I started with Kubernetes 1.5 years ago with my master thesis, from which this current project we're talking about sparked.
Yeah, I'm basically doing the same, just a little bit longer. Yeah. So what can you expect from our talk? The first thing is you should know some challenges when using network policies, because that's not trivial. You should see some different aspects of testing and validating your setup, so mostly focused on Kubernetes, obviously. And you should also see some different testing strategies and how you can use different tools to solve different problems, for example. And just a little question here to the audience and a little bit morning sport, so just raise your hand. So who of you is using Kubernetes? Okay, I think nearly everyone. Who of you uses network policies in Kubernetes? Okay, not so many people, okay. Who had ever some issues with network policies because they blocked something? Okay, okay, great. We also had some fun and some challenges. So yeah, that's why we are here and why we built this thing. Well, Maximilian will talk about. So we'll talk a little bit more about the theoretical parts. Why should I test my network policies? And what aspects are here and how you can test them? So everybody that knows Kubernetes or had the opportunity to use Kubernetes knows that it's a pretty complex part system with many adjustment screws. You have thousands of flags that you can provision your cluster, your components. And the interesting question always is, do all these flags work together? Or maybe I have set a flag that will be ignored or just don't work. And the main question is, how do I know about it if everything works or still works? And the next funny part is that Kubernetes doesn't implement the network policies itself. So it's just a resource in Kubernetes, and the CNI plugin, for example, has to read the network policies and implement them, or not, because the network policies are not part of the CNI, for example. It's just a part of Kubernetes itself. And the next not so funny part is that you don't get any feedback. So for example, if you use Flannel or you set up a GKE cluster without network policies enabled and you create a network policy, you don't know if the network policy is implemented or not, because you don't get any feedback. It's just there or not. And also the network policies have evolved over time, so they got more features, got a little bit broader features, and the other thing is, how do you know which part of the Kubernetes network policies are actually supported by the CNI plugin? So for example, maybe they only support just a little part of the Kubernetes network policies, but how do you know if this it will support everything? And the next funny thing is, this is just a little outcut here from the official network plugins for Kubernetes. It's from the Kubernetes documentation, and these are not all plugins that are there listed. These are just all plugins with a logo, and you can see there are pretty many things, and all the things they are doing is a little bit different. So some tools are using IP tables, for example, for the network policies. Some using IPSet. Some using eBPF, like Xilium, for example. Some others using NFTables. Some others doing, I don't know, some other stuff maybe. So it's pretty interesting to see how these things are solved. And the next thing is here, we have two policies, and policies are not always easy to read. And who can spot the difference? It's not a missing, it's both policies are valid. And the left one here without a dash is an AND combination, and the one with the dash, so this one, here is an OR, for example. So both policies look pretty similar, just a little dash, which can be easily overseen, but have a completely different meaning in the end. And it's not that trivial to see such things. And actually, if you have looked into network policies, these network policies are pretty trivial in if you compare it to what options you have, how to implement or how to use the network policies. Yeah, the next funny part or interesting part is you have many components. For example, you have the kubeproxy normally when you're running Kubernetes, or you don't have it if you use something that can replace the kubeproxy. And if you switch, for example, the backend mode from kubeproxy to, from IP tables to IPvS, do you know if your network policies still work or if the routing is now different and maybe the addresses now look different? Or if you update your CNI plugin, for example, to another version, do you still know if the network policies still work? Or maybe the network policies are now working as expected and before they just didn't work as they shouldn't work, but they work for your context? This was the case in the early days for pod security policies, for example, where there are some bugs in the validation of network policies. And yes, so it's a pretty interesting and complex world. And yeah, there are also conformance tests for Kubernetes, which are pretty nice, at least to know that you have a roughly working Kubernetes cluster. But for example, the conformance tests currently don't test any network policies or any airbag rules. There are some ideas how to create conformance tests with different testing profiles, for example, so that you can test network policies with the conformance test, but this is just something for the future, maybe if someone implements this. Yeah, then now the next question is, what can we test? I think everybody will agree that testing is probably a good idea if you are running in this complex world and have a more or less big or complex setup. So in general, we thought you can have these two IAM areas. So on the left side, from your point of view, we have some conformance, for example. So we can say every user has to create a default deny policy, for example, if he creates a network policy. This is more conformance or governance around your cluster, and it's not really testing or looking into the policies, how they're actually working. And on the right side, you now have the actual implementation, and you can validate, for example, if the network policy, so the control plane, is actually synchronized between your Kubernetes cluster, because there could be some delay, depending on how large your cluster is, the delay can be pretty big, for example. And on the right, you have the data plane in the end, so you will probably check if your network policies are actually taking effect, for example. And there are different approaches, so you can do active testing or passive testing, but Maximilian will talk about this a little bit more in depth now.
Yeah, so I'm taking over now. and I want to tell you how to actually test policies. So I'm going back to the same diagram again. So for conformance, like what users can submit or should submit, we can just query the control plane, the Kubernetes API, and just check that the policies that are in the cluster like fit our company policies. So I'm going to name OPA later on too, but you've probably heard about Open Policy Agent that does exactly that. So you could use that for checking that your users conform to your company policies when using network policy. For synchronization, we can either like passively check CNI logs, so like this pattern here with control plane and data plane for e.g. Calico, which I know best of all the CNI plugins would be like they have this agent on each node running, and you can check these agent logs to see if you picked up the policy and then generated a IP table with rules that bend the traffic to fit these policies. And we could also, so that would be entirely passive because we're just reading logs, and we could also apply policies to like get some reaction and maybe even measure like how long does the synchronization test, when does it work and when doesn't it work. Yeah, and for effective policies, we can like passively just read traffic, so using TCP dump or reading logs again, or like check the IP tables rules that are e.g. generated by Calico, or we can actively, like using curl or something, generate traffic that mimics the traffic, the pods, like that's limited by the network policies. And that's something I'm gonna talk about more in depth now. So this is the approach we chose. Because the upside of this is that we are basically testing the whole process, because if we are like testing pod-to-pod traffic, we are also testing that the control plane synchronized the policies, otherwise they wouldn't work. So there are some technical approaches to like generate this traffic. So one pretty transparent one would be just like taking a pod spec. So let's say we have this pod foo and it's affected by a network policy in some way. And we want to test like, can it reach another pod? Then we can just take the pod spec, copy the whole pod and replace the container image with a test image, and this test image could just run like curl or wget or whatever to check that traffic can go out of this pod or cannot go out of this pod. Or if we are using Docker in our cluster, we can just attach to an existing pod. So you probably know when Kubernetes generates or when the kubelet starts the containers for your pod, it starts a pause container and your actual workload container or containers. And the pause container also sets up the network namespace. So you can just use docker run dash dash net pause or foo pause or whatever it's called, this really long name you've probably seen before, and attach your own testing container that then in turn uses curl or whatever you choose to test your traffic. So that has some one downside. So for each test case you want to execute, you have to run a new Docker container to attach to this pause container. And it obviously only does work with Docker. But the upside is it's like really simple if you're using Docker, because you can just use the CLI and it's like doing all the stuff for you, and you have no problems with privileges or anything. And if you want to go even deeper or even more to like the OS, even lower, you can directly attach to a network namespace. So again, each container runtime interface runtime will create this pause container, and we can just use any existing pod in our cluster, which then requires privileges to see the other processes and run privileged. And we can then attach to the network namespace using e.g. NSEnter from our test pod to the pause container of our tested pod. So I hope it's not too abstract, but I'm also going to show a little bit more about that soon. So yeah, how would this look in practice? So we could use different tools, like I already named wget and curl. So maybe you just created your network policy in your cluster, you only want to know, yeah, okay, is traffic denied like I expect it to be? Then you can just exec into your pod and use curl or wget, and like in the pod that should allow traffic, that should traffic allowed be from, and use curl, and then you'll see either, okay, traffic got through, like I'm seeing my backend services page or whatever, or it didn't work. And the downside to this tool is that you have to provide it in the container for each application you want to test from. There's also an existing tool called NetAssert that's on GitHub. I've put a link here. And what you do there is like you provide your configuration that's specified on the GitHub page too. And NetAssert reads this configuration. So in this case, it would like test from a deployment in default namespace named foo to a deployment in the same namespace named bar. And it would test that TCP port 80 is open. And then what NetAssert does for you is this Docker approach I explained. So it runs like a container, and this container runs in the network, in the Docker network of the POS container of the foo pod. And then it can, in turn, use nmap to check, to probe whether traffic to the bar, bar pod through the bar service is possible. So this works pretty well. You just have to provide your own test YAML, your own config YAML, and you also have to have Docker and SSH access, because that's how NetAssert like starts its pods, it or its containers for testing. And then it also collects the results for you, obviously, and prints that to standard out. Our issue with that was that we didn't use Docker in our usual cluster setups. So we developed our own solution. It's called Illuminator. It's also on GitHub. You can also check it out. And what we also wanted to solve is the part of test case generation. Because it's partly useful to say, like, OK, these are my expectations as an operator, like what the network policies should do. But Illuminator also gives you, like, its opinion what they should do, so it parses the network policies and generates test cases like go from pod foo to pod bar and tell me whether traffic is possible or not, or tell me that traffic is possible because it should be allowed. And what we do in the background is like create a daemon set, and that launches on each node a pod, and this pod uses NSEnter to enter the network namespace of the port we want to generate traffic from. So in this approach, we basically don't interfere with any production traffic at all, because we just hook into the network namespace of an existing port. We get traffic out, but there's like nothing coming in, or it's not like we have to deploy an additional port, which then would probably accept production traffic. The same is also true for NetAssert, because they are running a separate container. Yeah. So I also want to talk a little bit of this, about this test case generation part, because that's like quite complicated. So I want to look at this network policy. You probably then all have seen it, because most of you raised your hands. This is just a simple network policy that takes effect in namespace default, and then it selects pods with some label selector. And like how network policies work internally is every pod that is now selected, like every pod in namespace default that is selected by this label selector, is isolated from every traffic except the one that is defined in ingress or egress rules. So this is quite easy to parse and to generate test cases from, because now we have like this part, okay, my pod is isolated except for this traffic, so we can test like, okay, a pod that matches the conditions in this ingress rule should be allowed to reach our Prometheus pod, and a pod that doesn't match the conditions should not be allowed to connect to this Prometheus pod. But if we have multiple policies, it gets complicated very fast. Like maybe our Prometheus pod also has another label that is used in another network policy, and now we suddenly allow some traffic that wasn't intended initially. Yeah, and another what I've already named is like, we want to generate two kinds of tests. So we don't only want to test that traffic is allowed, because the default in Kubernetes is all traffic is allowed. So if network policies never take effect, we wouldn't even recognize it. But we also have to like inverse basically what is contained in these ingress rules and test from pods that don't match this label selector or these conditions in the ingress rules to be sure that traffic is also denied from pods which should not be allowed. Yeah. And for multiple policies, it gets complicated fast. Because, so maybe you can spot how these two policies interact. So the left policy only selects, only allows traffic from App Grafana. And the right policy allows traffic from namespace selector empty, so all namespace labels, and pod selector team ops. So in this case, our traffic would be allowed because our namespace does like match the condition. So whatever namespace pod B is in, it matches the condition. And it also has the team ops label. But maybe we initially only meant that Prometheus should only be allowed to be accessed from Grafana. And this other policy just overwrote what we intended to do. So one upside is that Illumination also generates test cases that clearly state these intents, at least like how we programmed it to. So you get at least like an overview in your cluster. Maybe your test cases all work, but it still looks like wonky, the test cases that were generated. So you can see that with Illumination. Yeah. So we've prepared a short demo. Where's my terminal? Okay. So let's see. Okay. So we've got two clusters here, and both are on Google Kubernetes Engine. I think Johannes already mentioned, like, there when you create a cluster in GKE, you have to set a flag specifically to enable network policy. So we have one currently selected as context that has exactly that, like it has network policy enabled. We got, oops, we, oh, sorry, okay. So we got some namespaces. Let's start with that. Works. Set up for our demo. So the other namespace is also labeled. And we've got a network policy. So this network policy affects namespaces, allows ingress from namespaces that are in that are labeled team operations. So our other namespace meets this condition. And only from pods in these namespaces that also have the labels type monitoring. And it allows traffic to pods in namespace default that have these labels. So we should also have one meeting that condition there. So if we now run Illumination. Yes. No. Okay. So if we now run Illumination, we see it generates four test cases. So this one is the easiest one. We just want to know that from namespaces labeled team operations, we allow traffic and pods type monitoring in this namespace. We allow traffic to our application. And then the other ones are different variations on traffic that is not allowed. So the top one is we have another namespace labeled in team operations. And the matching pod label, so this one was not allowed. And we have one where both labels do not match, and one where the namespace label matches, but the pod label doesn't. And the syntax for this asterisk is like all pods are allowed because network policies can also specify ports, or any port should work, and the minus means it should not be allowed. So in this case, our network policies were enabled on GKE and our tests were successful. So our policy works exactly as we expected. And how we tested that is like Illumination generated one namespace called Illumination where the daemon set was deployed. And they did all that stuff with NSEnter in the background and used nmap to check that ports are open or not open. And then it also generated extra namespaces for testing. So this is currently how we implemented it, but we could also, like, if you do not want namespaces to be generated or anything, that could also be changed in the future. So we are very happy if you want to submit a patch for that or like make this optional. Yeah, but currently the behavior is like we generated a new namespace where the labels are different than team operations and test from that one. And yeah, in namespace other, we have also some pods that are some dummy pods that are generated that either meet our condition or don't meet our condition of being labeled type monitoring. So I can also show the labels here. Yeah, so one has type monitoring, the bottom one, and the other one has like not type monitoring, basically. Yeah, that's basically how Illuminator works, and just to show that it works and that we didn't cheat, I'm also gonna run it on my other cluster where everything should be set up the same. And I get a warning because I shouldn't use my kube config like that, according to GKE. And so we are generating the same test cases, so the setup is probably the same. And then our tests are failing for denied traffic because, like we stated before, if network policies aren't enabled, all traffic is allowed. So now Illuminatio detects, okay, traffic wasn't denied, that's bad. And complains. So. Okay, time to wrap up. So I've shown you some tools, Illuminatio and NetAssert mainly, that you can use. So and you can use them to test, like use whatever fits your setup and to test whether your policies take effect. If you also want like to check this user policy interaction, so users should maybe only be allowed to submit a network policy in namespaces where default deny policy is applied to not get any confusion. And then you can use something like Open Policy Agent, or specifically Open Policy Agent. I think this tool has quite some hype, and it is also deserved hype because it works very well. It's, if you understand Rego, the weird language they ship with, it's pretty easy to use. And if you just want to validate your policies in any way without user interaction, you can also use Open Policy Agent, run once against your cluster, or you can use Kube Audit that has at least one check, I believe, that checks that network policies are in your cluster and every namespace. I think default deny policy is what they check. And you could also, which is not mentioned on the slide, run the Kubernetes end-to-end tests specifically for network policies. So they are not part of the conformance suite, but you can still run them and they test some network policies in their own setup. So I'm giving back to you for a short recap.
So the first recap or the first thing that we noticed is that we, or you always should test your assumptions, for example. So if you create a network policy, it's nice to trust that a CNI plugin will implement them, but in the end, it's better from our perspective to actually test it and not test it just once and just test it multiple times, for example. So regression testing can make your life easier since the Kubernetes ecosystem is pretty complex, or you have the multiple components, for example, they need to interact in some kind of a way, and regression testing makes it easier to see, okay, some update, for example, crashed on my setup or behaves completely different before. And also from our perspective, at least, network policies are still hard to get right. Also, we are just focusing currently on the Kubernetes network policies. Plugins like Calico, for example, or Cilium also have another type of network policies. So there are their internal policies, for example, so they can allow global network policies or Calico policies, for example, and they also behave some kind like the Kubernetes network policies. And it's pretty sad that you don't get any feedback how and if they implemented from our perspective. And the next interesting thing is, it's not really a bug, it's more a feature from Weave, for example. So we tested it with Weave, and in the default setting, the behavior was that traffic to services was are affected by the network policies, but if you called directly a pod, for example, the network policy didn't take any effect, because I think in Weave the default is to don't masquerade the traffic. So that's just something that's not as expected, because you talk to the service, everything works fine, but now you call directly the pod, which is not that hard, and now the network policy don't take any effect. Not like it should be. So yeah, a little bit outlook where we want to go with Illuminatio. We are probably looking at the ephemeral containers, which are now in alpha for 1.16. And this could help us to make it a little bit easier, just to spawn a container inside of a pod. And this would make it easier for us, and Illuminatio would need such many privileges as it currently needs, because to make an NS enter into a network namespace, you need some kind of privileges, obviously. And if you're running in a more or less restricted environment with pod security policies, and you want to have the least privileges, this is probably not the best idea, but currently it works, and it was the easiest way to implement it for current kind. Yeah, so in the end, our main goal in the future is to write some kind of conformance test suite to test, for example, the CNI plugins in your Kubernetes cluster, and just to check how much of the policies are they implementing and which kind of the policies implementing. So do they only implement the basic stuff or also the advanced stuff, for example? Yeah, and in the end, we also want to add more network policies, so network in general, so that we, for example, also support the Calico policies, the Cilium policies, or maybe the Istio policies, for example. So Istio as a service mesh has a pretty big hype currently, because you can set MTLS with policies and co. But I probably believe that not so much people actually test if these policies actually working as they should. And that's always an interesting part, because if you use some policies, or if you have a firewall, for example, and you believe it should be working, but it doesn't work, it's pretty bad. So yeah, this is Illuminatio. Feel free to try it or give some feedback. It's probably pretty opinionated by us from our experiences, but feel free to ask us now anything, or after the talk, for example, feel free to come to us and talk about your experience you made with network policies or testing in this Kubernetes world. So we're pretty happy to get any feedback. Yeah, and that's our contact. Yeah. Any questions?
Thanks. That is, you create new pods. You create new pods with the correct labels to be able to test. Is there a risk that the normal traffic to service are redirected to those new pods? On break normal traffic?
Maybe I didn't explain this well enough. So the idea is the pods that we create, they don't have any labels that should be like matched by any service themselves. So those pods just run, basically waiting for their test cases to be put as a config map, and then they attach using NSEnter to the actual workloads. So the pods never have like any labels that should be selected by a service. They also don't run in a namespace together with any of your production services. They run in a separate namespace. But through the Linux magic, basically, that is network namespaces, we can still enter the network namespace of our pod we want to test from, and then create traffic as if we were a container in that pod without actually like having any traffic routed to us, because we don't open any ports or anything.
I think the main point here is that only the client side gets generated and not the server side mostly.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Maybe I misunderstood the question. Yeah.
Thanks. So it's safe to run this in production cluster?
From our experience, yes. So it should be. If you know, see anything that's not safe, please tell us. But like we said, we only generate the client side, and we only generate the client side if it's needed. So if there are, for example, pods that already match the criteria, we don't need to generate a pod. We just use the pods that are actually there.
Got a question? Yeah. Hey, so cool talk. Thanks a lot. From my experience of breaking network policies, the bugs that I found were in when you update a condition. So the policy is static, but you add or remove labels from either a client or server pods. Obviously, you can't do that on a running cluster, but have you tried to do this in offline or destructive tests of clusters? That would be awesome.
Thanks for the feedback.
I noticed you use Python on Nmap. Do you require that as a dependency on the node, on the host?
Currently, what we are doing is we spawn a so-called Illumination Runner pod. And inside of the pod, we already installed Python and Nmap. And so you don't require anything on your host.
Do you require SSH on the host?
Nope.
No.
That was one requirement from our side, because in the current production setup we don't have any SSH access to the clusters. And we also didn't want to have like an Ansible style, so that you always have to do some SSH to the containers. And also, our idea was that if you have the Illumination Runner, for example, on each node, they can run independently. And so, for large clusters, it should be a little bit faster than doing it in a parallel SSH, for example. So that's why we built it like this.
Thanks.
So any more questions? Then thanks for listening.